Hey pals, I'm here today to do a library book haul. A couple of like caveats here. Firstly, I'm sure you've heard, because British people are very good at complaining about the weather, whatever it is insanely hot for the UK. We don't have aircon in our buildings as like a standard, so I'm sweaty, okay? So if I look shiny and sweaty, that's why. And I also feel sort of like vindicated in this, because most people I know spend the rest of the year saying, oh, like we get such a rubbish summer in the UK, like we never get any warm weather, oh, why isn't it sunny? And then as soon as it's actually hot, they complain constantly and want it to be autumn. Whereas Johnny and I spend all three other seasons dreading the summer, and then when summer's here, hating it if it gets above 17 degrees Celsius. So I feel like at least I'm not being a hypocrite about the weather. Roll on autumn is what I say. So, and hopefully these books can get me through some of this hot weather. I can just stay indoors in the coolest room in our house. We live in a Victorian terrace, and if you live in a small Victorian terrace in the UK, you will know that the dining rooms, which are like in between the front living room and the back kitchen, they just have like a little window on the side, like usually barely get any sun, which we love because it's always cold. In the winter it's very cold, but this time of year it's perfect. So that's pretty much where I'll be living for the next few days. That's my little talk about the temperature that you probably didn't want to hear anyway. So there's that. And the other thing is that I know it's ridiculous that I'm doing a library book haul just after a reading stats and TBR zero check-in video, okay? I'm aware of that. I know I have about 65 unread books on my shelves that I want to read by the end of the year. If I want to manage that, I need to read 12 a month. I'm barely reading 12 books a month at the moment. Probably not going to achieve it, but yet I have more library books to show you. I know. What happened is, I'd requested a lot of books from my library over the course of probably the last 4 months, and they were like, a lot of them were new books, and they've just all arrived in. And then I went in the library today with Sarah from the channel Your Tree Shelf. I'll link her channel above. I really recommend her channel. I really enjoy it. She lives near me, and we met today for the first time and had brunch. I went to Waterstones in the library, and it was lovely. And being in the library reminded me even more of how much I cannot wait to have a zero TBR, because pre-BookTube I didn't have a single unread book. I had all of my favourite books which I'd kept for years and reread like a gazillion times, and then I had library books, and it was only when I joined BookTube that I started buying books and shit got out of hand. And we went to Waterstones and the library probably for a similar amount of time, probably ended up spending longer in the library actually, and I enjoyed the library so much more. I just love that. I'm quite fortunate, I think I've mentioned this before, my library has a US section, which means that it has books that aren't actually published in the UK, which Waterstones doesn't have. So I feel like in a way the library has more choice. Well, it does, I mean it's way bigger than our Waterstones. But I love the feeling of the library. I love that the books are all like wrapped in plastic wrap. I love knowing that like other people have read and enjoyed these books. I love that there's no guilt when you pick them up, like you haven't paid for them. If you don't like them, you can take them back. I just love it. And so yeah, like in a way it's a good thing for me to continue to use the library this year, because it encourages me to see the positives in what I'm aiming for. That's my excuse. So on to the books. I think I've got 11 here, so it's not too bad. Although one other thing is, I thought the limit was 20 books you're allowed out. It used to be 12 pre-COVID, and they increased it. But Sarah said to me, I don't think there is a limit, I've got 25 books out. So now I've got 25 books out as well. I sort of wish I didn't know there wasn't a limit, because it forced me to like actually weed them in a timely fashion. But yeah, I do know now, so I can't take it back. So the first three are books that are new releases, and I requested them and yeah, just come in. The first one is like a big hitter at the moment, and that is Nightcrawling by Layla Motley. This has a completely different cover in North America, and I can't decide which one I prefer. I really think both are like really great. This is the North American cover. Which one do you prefer? I think this one is more bold in colour, but I feel like this one is more bold in the imagery. I don't know. So I like them both. But the premise of this is that about a 17-year-old girl who lives in, do I know where this is set? I don't think I do, it doesn't say here. Although this is based on a real case, which was where a group of male police officers were found out to have been taking advantage of a group of young sex workers, and there was this like criminal case over it, and that inspired the author to write this book. So it's about a 17-year-old girl who is sort of having to raise her younger brother alone because her mother's really struggling and their older brother sort of left them for other things, and she starts night calling, which is a term for sex work, and gets involved with these officers. And I think this is supposed to be pretty dark and gritty, but a really compulsive read. So yeah, I'm a bit nervous to go into this one, but I'm also really intrigued to see where this goes, because yeah, I think it's supposed to be pretty like twisty, and I have no expectations for where the plot will go. So there's that one. The second one, I really like this cover too, is These Impossible Things by Salma El-Badani. I asked my library to buy a copy of this and they kindly did. And yeah, I love the sound of this. Quite a few years ago, I read a book called Expectation by Anna Hope. Here is the cover. That was about three or four women who grew up as friends in Britain, all made different life choices, and sort of all envied one another's choices, and it really impacted their friendship. And this is sort of a similar theme, but this one follows three British Muslim women. So I'm really interested to see like the different dynamics of their friendship. And again, they all make these different choices. But I think in this novel, there's an event that happens one night that like really shakes their friendship and changes who they all become. And it's something they sort of look back on as they're reflecting on their choices. So yeah, really like the sound of this one. The author looks really cool. I think she looks pretty badass in that photo. I always love to have a little sneaky look at the author picture. So yeah, very excited to get to this one. I think I'll put this one up really soon. And also, when I have new releases out from the library, I'm very cognizant that like other people could want to borrow them, even if they're not on hold from someone else. I try and read them quick to get them like back on the shelves for other people, so these first three will probably be top priority. This next one was a recommendation from a subscriber, and that is The Cherry Robbers by Sarai Walker. I think this author previously wrote a book called Dietland, which I think is supposed to be a pretty funny novel about diet culture. So yeah, I don't tend to read humorous books, but when the subscriber mentioned it, I looked, and obviously brilliant title, brilliant cover, which really drew me in. And then I had a read, and I'm intrigued by this one. So I'm very excited to give it a go. I love historical fiction, but the majority of historical fiction I read, well, predominantly it's set in Britain, and then I guess I've also read a lot that I've really enjoyed that's set in like Southeast Asia. This is set in Connecticut in 1950, and I feel like I've read very few books set in like historical America. So yeah, we'll see how I go with this one. So this is set between 1950s Connecticut and New Mexico in 2017. Or 2015, one of the two. In the 1950s, we follow these five sisters who are the Chapel sisters, and their family are the heirs to a firearms legacy. Their mother is mentally ill, and she believes she sees the ghosts of the people who've been killed by their weapons around the house. And all of the daughters are married off, but they start to realise that being married off like equals death. So one of them tries to escape, and I think we're following the one who tried to escape in the like more present storyline, but she has a different name, so like she like escaped her previous life. So yeah, I think that sounds pretty intriguing, and like this is an amazing cover. They did a brilliant job. There's that. These next two were books that I saw when I was browsing. The first one I was super excited to see because this isn't published in the UK. I think it's probably only published in North America, and I'm pretty sure it was Kendra I heard talk about this one over at the channel Kendra Winchester, which I'll also link above. I love Kendra's recommendations. And yeah, I really like the sound of it and thought, oh, that's one I'll like have to buy eventually because I won't be able to get that from the library. And what do you know, I saw it there and I was so excited. So I was like, I have to borrow this one today. And that is Crooked Hallelujah by Kelly J. Ford. I think this came out a couple of years ago. And this is set in 1974 in the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma. We follow a 15-year-old girl who's being raised by her mother, and she sees this violent act take place, and it sort of shakes the foundations of her life. And then we follow her family going forward, but it says this follows the four generations of Cherokee women who will sacrifice for those they love amid larger questions of history, religion, class and culture. I really enjoy coming of age stories. This girl is 15, and I also love stories that look at like matriarchs, particularly like intergenerational families of women. I think that's really intriguing, and so yeah, I'm hoping to really enjoy this one. I've heard really good things. And then the next one, this has just been published in the last year or so in both the US and the UK. It's got completely different covers. I do think the UK cover really stands out. Like, I immediately spotted the spine on the bookshelf, and that is Reprieve by James Han Mattson. This is a really odd one for me because this is a like straight up horror novel. And weirdly, I don't read much horror at all now, but when I was about maybe 12, 13, I read like just point horror, like solidly read point horror for like a year, and I loved it. And yeah, I just stopped reading horror, and I don't read horror at all as an adult. And I subscribe to quite a few people now who read a decent amount of horror, and I want to try and get back into it. And I'm pretty sure I heard Sian talk about this one over at Storytime. Again, I'll link the channel above. I love Sian and Bert. I don't know if Sian's read this yet, but I definitely saw her haul it. I think maybe the library as well. And yeah, this is basically set in a full contact escape room. My friend once invited me to a full contact escape. No, it wasn't an escape, it was like a Halloween experience at this like old hall that's like hundreds of years old. And I was like, no, not like, I'm not down to pay money for people to like touch me in the dark. Like, not nice touch me, like trying to scare me. That's messed up. But these people are willing to do it because it is a like game show. And if they manage to get through the whole experience without shouting the word reprieve, which allows them to leave, they'll win $60,000. And it's about the fact that somebody is murdered in one of these escape rooms, and the book opens with the investigation and the interviews, and then I think it like looks back on what happened. And the reason I decided to give this one a go is because I've heard people say that this is a really interesting discussion about race and class in America, and I feel like that's further confirmed by the fact that the quote on the front is from Kisei Lemon, who I love his memoir Heavy. It's like one of the best books I've ever read, and he writes predominantly books and articles about race and gender and class stereotypes in the US. So the fact that he's like said this is great makes me think this is going to be a really interesting discussion. So very intrigued by this one. Then I have a couple of romance novels. I don't read a ton of romance, but when I do, I either borrow them from the library or get them on my Kindle, because they're not books I'd necessarily reread, but I really enjoy the experience of like reading through a romance book in like 3 hours and just like binge reading a book. So I've got a couple. This first one is a trope I quite enjoy, which is Lease on Love by Fallon Ballard. This is about a woman who goes on what she thinks is a dating app, meets this guy for what she thinks is a date, she really likes him, and then realises that actually she was on a room sharing app and he is meeting her to be his flatmate. And then she's like, actually, I really like your like swanky brownstone apartment, so I'm going to move in anyway. And it's about what happens after that, so I think that sounds fun. And the next one has a really bright and beautiful cover, and that is Lucy Yi Is Not a Romantic by Lauren Ho. I don't think this is a debut novel, I think she might have a couple of other novels out, but this is the one I've heard of. She believes that Mr. Right doesn't exist, but then she meets easygoing Colin Reed on a platonic co-parenting website. It feels like she has found her version of happily ever after, but things take a turn for the worse when they move back home to Singapore, where her very traditional family and remorseful ex-fiancé wait. And it's about like all the pressures her family put on her and their expectations. I think like interracial relationships and family expectations in romance novels is something I really enjoy. I've enjoyed it in a couple of romance novels I've read previously that I can't think of right now, but yeah, I've heard really good things about that one. And then I have a couple of YA fantasy novels, the first being the third and final book in a trilogy, and that is The Excalibur Curse by Kirsten White. This is the third book in the Camelot Rising trilogy. So I read both the previous books in one sitting. This is clearly a retelling of like the whole King Arthur story. It's about Guinevere, and I feel like the second book shouldn't have existed. It should clearly have been a duology. I pretty much saw where the story was going, but halfway through book one, the characters are a bit slow on the uptake, and we spend the whole of the second book being like, maybe this is it, and you're like, it is, it definitely is. So I feel like, even though I didn't love the second one, I have to finish it, because where I think the story's going, I like, and we're finally gonna get there. So I will probably like speed through this one at some point during the next week or so. And the other one is Vespertine by Margaret Rogerson. I've read both her previous books and enjoyed them both. I find them just like really easy, sort of cozy, fantastical YA books with quite a heavy amount of romance. What is this one about? I have no idea. Artemisia, which is a cool name, is training to be a Grey Sister, a nun who cleanses the bodies of the deceased so that their souls can pass on. Otherwise, they will rise as spirits with a ravenous hunger for the living. Then her convent is attacked by possessed soldiers, and she wakes some sort of ancient spirit. Sounds a little bit similar to the last book by this author. And yeah, I'm sure there's some sort of romance. I'm sure I'll have fun reading this one. And yeah, I think her books all have like really cool covers. If you're into that sort of YA fantasy vibe covers, I think her books have decent ones. And then finally, I have two non-fiction books. I just heard Vanessa over at Split Reads talk about this one in a recent wrap-up video, I think. I'll link the video above. Vanessa is one of my absolute favourite channels for non-fiction recommendations. So if you're into non-fiction, if you like the sort of stuff I read, you'll definitely enjoy hearing Vanessa talk about non-fiction. She's a librarian. She has amazing recommendations for non-fiction, also middle grade, and really good for graphic novels as well. So go check her channel out. The book is Nobody's Victim, Fighting Psycho, Stalkers, Pervs and Trolls by Carrie Goldberg. Carrie Goldberg, it says she is on the front lines of the war against sexual violence. She is a lawyer, I think, and it says, in gripping detail, Carrie shares the diabolical ways her clients are attacked and how she, for her unique combination of relentless advocacy, badass risk-taking and unique client empowerment, pursues justice for them all. There is the ex-boyfriend who made fake bomb threats in a client's name, causing a national panic, the girl who was sexually assaulted on school grounds and then suspended when she reported the attack, and the guy who used a dating app to send more than 1,200 men to his ex's homes and offers for sex. Carrie also shares her own shattering story about why she began her work and became the lawyer she needed. So yeah, I think that sounds really interesting. I find, like, I would never want to be a lawyer. I have to work with contracts, a little bit of work, and I find it desperately boring. So I admire people who go through all the, like, insanely boring parts of studying law to be able to, like, work on, like, these really important cases. But I do find the cases, like, and the law around them in court really interesting and obviously incredibly infuriating, because we live in a fucked up world where, like, justice is barely ever served. So yeah, I'm sure this book will make me very angry, but I'm hoping it also makes me feel a bit of hope in that there are people like this author, like, fighting for people out there. So there's that one. And then this last one, I was just going through, like, the online app to see what my library had recently purchased. I've never heard of this book. I saw the cover, was intrigued, looked into it and thought, I definitely want to read this one. And that is Birth Notes, A Memoir of Recovery by Jessica Cornwell. Isn't that a cool cover? It's quite like the Salma al-Wadani cover, like, where there's, like, shapes to make a form, which is something I've realised I really like. So the premise of this is that this author had two twins, I think boys, and yeah, twin boys, and she was rushed back to hospital after she was diagnosed with a life-threatening infection. It says that when she was recovering, she stopped feeling, not just physically, but mentally. She stopped feeling any, like, emotions. And, like, these awful, vivid memories started to surface of moments in her past she thought she buried. And it says, she began to name one by one the shadows that returned to haunt her first year as a mother, and in claiming back the words, she fought to claim back her life and the love she bore her family. With eloquent rage and searing honesty, it speaks for the unvoiced and shines a light on maternal mental health. It is the love story of a mother for her children and of a woman for herself. I will try and read this and, like, feedback on, like, obviously if I enjoyed it, but also how difficult those sections were. I think this could be quite triggering for, like, lots of different reasons. So, like, obviously look up content warnings and decide if this is something for you. So yeah, they're all the books. I've just realised I have quite a lot of hardbacks there. So quite a lot of new releases. Which one should I get to first? I have no idea. I'm feeling a little bit drawn to... I'm very drawn to Reprieve, just because it's really different to anything I've read before. And I also think I'm just always, always, always going to be drawn to books like this. Like, books about women and, like, the choices they make and the connections they have. So, yeah, I think I will pick this one up pretty soon as well. Thanks so much for watching. Let me know if you have any books you've recently borrowed from the library. I would love to know. I also just love hearing about people's libraries and their library experiences, so put them all down below. And I'll see you in the next video. Bye!